First of all, I would like to thank the organizer for giving me the opportunity to present my work here. And what I'm going to discuss is based on this series of papers that I wrote in collaboration with Ofer Aroni, Fernando Aldai, and Derek Permutter. So the whole idea and the whole program of this paper is essentially to study how scattering amplitudes in ADS spaces can be computed using CFT techniques applied to the dual correlator. So that's the whole program that we tried to study here, and then mostly we report something which is in the last paper here. So why did we really care about studying scattering amplitudes? So scattering amplitudes might uncover structure of a theory which are not really apparent from the Lagrangian formulation of the theory. And also using traditional techniques, scattering amplitudes in curved spaces are very hard to study, also for very low genus and also for genus zero. So today I mostly will focus on string theory amplitudes. And for these cases, we were very interested in understanding how much of the full structure, which is a very rich structure, of the string amplitude can be recovered or even predicted from the dual CFT description, only using the symmetries of the CFT. In particular, this also provides a test of ADS-CFT correspondence away from the planar limit and from the protected sector of the theory. So what is the talk about? My talk is about presenting a setup to compute and constrain genus 1 for graviton amplitudes in string theory on ADS5 process 5 in a low energy expansion. So here I made this plot, and the first one is a genus 0 amplitude. This is the genus 1 and then higher genus. So what I will be interested about is this object here in the box. And as I wrote here, this is a genus 1 string amplitude. And it is a function of some parameters. So ST and U are the Mandelstam variables. And this is also a function of alpha prime. And when I say that I study in a low energy expansion, I will take an expansion for small alpha prime. So the first term will be the supergravity one loop term plus all the alpha prime corrections. And that will be exactly what I would like to discuss. And you will see actually this kind of formula towards the end of the talk. So let me first discuss the setup. So the setup I'm considering is essentially the SCFT correspondence, which all of you are very familiar with it, relates type 2V superstring theory in ADS5 cross S5 to four-dimensional n equal 4 super Yamiels with SUN gauge group. In particular, as I said before, I will be interested in discussing scattering amplitudes of gravitons, and this observable is related to correlators of stress tensors. So the limit I'm going to consider is a limit in which both n, which is the rank of the gauge group, and lambda are large. This is usually called supergravity approximation, while with the lambda expansion, we will probe correction to the supergravity approximation. In particular, the plot I showed you before was showing an expansion, a genus expansion, which is controlled by GS. So by doing this expansion in n, I will essentially will be doing the same kind of expansion in the CFT side. And in particular, to probe this this low energy expansion, I will be doing this expansion in large lambda, and it will be essentially the same as taking alpha prime to be small. And lambda is defined here, it's just n times g square Yamiels. So now I would like just to discuss what is the spectrum of n equal 4 a strong coupling, so in this particular limit I'm considering. So there are different classes of operators which behave in a different way. So there are protected half BPS single trace operators, which are scalar operator of this form here. The dimension is independent of lambda, is protected, and is equal to p. In particular, for when we have a p equal to 2, this scalar operator of dimension 2 in its super multiplet contains also the stress tensor. So it's essentially the same kind of operator that we were interested in. And then for p greater than 2, there are all the Kaluza-Klein modes. The other class of operator is unprotected single trace operator. So now this time the dimension of such object, for instance, maybe the most popular one is the Konishi operator. The dimension of such operator grows with a coupling constant, like lambda to the 1/4. Then there are double traces operator, which are composite operator of this schematic form here. In this case, the dimension of such an object is just the sum of the dimension of these two guys, plus 2 times n, which is the dimension of this, plus l, and then all the sequence of correction in n and in lambda. So now, since I will be studying the same, the limit that I told you before, we are in the supergravity approximation, so this kind of operator just a couple, so I won't consider these operators here. In addition, the loop correction to the supergravity, so remember there was supergravity here, then there are loop correction to supergravity, which will be labeled by the n expansion. So the first term will be supergravity, the second term will be the loop correction to supergravity, while lambda will instead parameterize the stringy correction to supergravity. And essentially, that's the kind of expansion I'm going to look at. There are also higher trace operators in general, but they won't play any role in my discussion because I will stop expanding at this order here, and they don't enter before that order. So which kind of expansion we are going to do and which kind of correlation function we are going to study? The correlation function we are going to study is a correlation function of this half BPS operator of dimension 2, and simply using conformal symmetry, one can write this four-point function as a function of U and V, which are the cross ratios, over this term here. The first expansion we are going to look at, as I said, we want to study the string amplitude in a genus expansion. So I'm going to do a large n expansion to mimic again this genus expansion. So we are going to expand this function g. So this is just the first term, then there will be the term which goes like 1 over n square or 1 over the central charge, which is exactly genus 0 plus genus 1 and so on. Then we are also going to take another expansion, which is the larger lambda expansion, which will mimic the alpha prime expansion. So again, we will take both G1 and G2, and we will be expanding them in lambda. So that's essentially the plan of the talk. I will first discuss this larger expansion and then the large lambda expansion. So let me first remind a few very basic information about CFTs. So as you all know, four-point function can be decomposed in conformal blocks. So in particular, if we have a four-point function, we can write it as this sum here. In particular, here I single out the contribution of the identity operator. And then you can write it as a sum over the dimension and the spin of the intermediate operators here, which appear in the OP, and times the conformal blocks, which are this function that I wrote it here, like u to the delta minus l over 2, and this function g. And what we have here is the three-point function squared, the three-point function of this operator, which were the half BPS protected operator, so O2, O2, O delta L. This is the square of such three-point function, which appear here and here. In the regime I'm discussing, as I said, that there are only in this OPE protected single trace operator and unprotected double trace operator, since I'm not considering this single trace unprotected. In addition to that, I will be heavily using crossing symmetry, which is nothing but the associativity of the OPE, which in this case takes this very simple form. Notice, try to remember this formula because it will be very important in a few seconds. So the main tool I'm going to use is the analytic bootstrap. So this slide might seem very trivial, but actually it has very, very strong consequences that unfortunately I don't have time to discuss in details. But the main observation is the fact that as V goes to zero, V is one of the cross ratios, the correlator develops singularities. And actually it turns out that the whole OP data, and in particular the whole correlator, can be reconstructed from these singularities that we have here. So it seems that this is a kind of weird thing, because it seems that you need to know the correlator in order to reconstruct the correlator, so it seems a bit naive. But actually, the most important point is that the structure of the singularity comes from coursing symmetry and the OP content. So you don't need to know the correlator to compute the singularities, but the singularities are much easier to understand than the full correlator. And this singularity fixes completely the three-point functions and the anomalous dimension. And from that, one can recover completely the correlator. Sorry. And this is a very strong statement, and is actually the key point while all this program is possible. So let me try to make this a bit clearer. So what I wrote here is nothing but the crossing symmetry relation that I had before, where I used the OP decomposition, the decomposition in conformal blocks of the correlator. So here you see you have the direct channel, and here I just wrote U over V square times GVU. So now you see a very nice thing. First of all, it is clear which kind of divergences we have. So here we have this V to the minus 2, and then we need to, we will have a divergence for the first term, a divergence from the second term as V goes to 0, and then starting from here, we don't have any divergence anymore. You see from the left-hand side that there are no divergences. All the powers will be increasing in this side. The most important thing that I wanted to show from this slide here are essentially two. The first one is the fact that the two operators which appear in the dual channel, which generates these divergences, are the identity, and this operator O2, which is protected. So the operator which generates these two divergences are very special operators. Another thing that I wanted to discuss is the fact that here, the kind of operators that we should have in order to reproduce these divergences here are my double trace operator, the other one that I'm discussing in this talk. So double trace operator, which should be infinitely many with large spin, are able to reproduce these power law divergences given by these two operators on the right-hand side. That's very, very important. And try to remember again that this, the operator that essentially control the divergences are the identity and this other operator, which is protected. So, okay, this is, again, I want to stress a lot this fact, that the fact that matching the divergences allows fixing the OP data up to finite spin ambiguities. And these ambiguities correspond to crossing symmetric solutions which don't have any divergence. And for such solution, the anomalous dimension and the three-point coupling is always zero. For spin which is large enough, in particular, is different from zero only for finitely many spins. And this kind of solution corresponds to quartic vertices in OIDS of this form here. And we will encounter that also later. So in particular, in addition to the power law singularities that we discussed before, there are also logarithmic singularities. And this will appear later in the talk, so try also to remember this bit. So I already said that, but just let me stress it again, that the whole correlator can be reconstructed from this kind of singularities or from the double discontinuity of the correlator. And again, also here, the same ambiguities are also present. So let me now rephrase a bit the strategy. The strategy will be to expand for large n both the three-point function and the dimension. And again, these three-point functions here and the dimension will be function of lambda. And then I will use crossing symmetry to fix the OP data by requiring the proper singularity structure that we just saw. Up to order n to the minus 2, there are only power law singularities, so we can compute the three-point function and the anomalous dimension, and actually we see a very nice structure. The anomalous dimension has this very nice form, so there will be the first bit, which is fixed by the singularities that I said before. Remember, the singularities were generated by the identity operator and by this other protected half VPS protected operator, plus a whole series of correction, which will be given by these ambiguities or this truncated solution of this form here. Sorry, here I wrote the same thing like gamma truncated, but indeed those are different objects. So the anomalous dimension is given by two terms. So this is fully fixed completely, also with all the numerical coefficients. Instead, this other solution are ambiguous in general. They can have coefficient in front here that I cannot fix because all the solutions are crossing symmetric by themselves. So now let me try to give a hint on how to go further, how we can construct by knowing the expansion up to order n to the minus 2, how we can go to order n to the minus 4. So again, remember that the idea is to expand both the dimension and the three-point function as a series in large n. So when we expand at order 1 over n to the 4, there will be several terms, but the most interesting and the only one which generates divergences, notice now that the divergence that we have is a logarithmic type, as I anticipated before, there is a term of this form. So you see that, again, this is the channel, the crossed symmetric channel, so there is u over v times this term here. Then when we expand, we will get a term which goes like n to the minus 4, coming from the expansion of this exponent here, which will produce this log square of v. And actually, the most important observation of this equation here is the fact that this singularity here comes with a factor which is very specific, which is the three-point function at order n to the 0 times the anomalous dimension at order n to the minus 2. And actually, we know both of them because we computed already by matching the singularities at previous order. So this is very interesting because this is a singularity, and the singularity has in front a coefficient that we are able to compute. So by matching this singularity, we are able to compute gamma 2 and also the full correlator. This is very nice, and this happens in all the cases. So it happens here I'm discussing animal 4, but it happens in any other case. So there will always be this term, and this term will always be in front of this log square v. So we are always able to reconstruct gamma 2 by knowing this information here. So now it comes a very interesting point. Remember again that the coefficient in front of the singularity is this gamma square. Now remember the form of the gamma that I showed you before. The gamma has this very nice structure. There is the first part, which is supergravity, and the second part, which is given by this truncated or ambiguities that we had before. So we have to take the square of this gamma here, so this is very little algebra. You can see that you get this piece, this other piece, and this other piece. So very nicely, you see that if you have this one loop with a diagram, you can just cut it into two, and you see that essentially you get the square of this diagram that you have seen before. So from this term here, you just square it, and you get the one loop supergravity here. And this kind of squaring works for all the terms. In particular, this is the leading term when we expand in large lambda. So this is essentially a term which goes like lambda to the 0. Then there is the second term, which goes like lambda to the 3 over 2. So again, here, this is made by this term here, which has the first gamma 1 in supergravity, and the second term, which is this truncated one. Here, this is the product of just two truncated solutions. So again, all the one loop can be reconstructed by squaring the three level. That's very nice, and it's very important, because we are able to reconstruct all the one loop diagram just by squaring three level diagrams. So I just wanted to summarize here the results that we got. So again, remember we have our four-point function. We can expand the four-point function in N. So we have, this is nothing but the disconnected term. This was the supergravity. And this is the first stringy solution, which is of this form there. There at one loop, we have the full sequence. So this is again one loop supergravity, and this is all the corrections here. Now remember, again, I wanted to stress again this fact that is very important, The fact that both the three-level supergravity and the one-loop supergravity are completely fixed by a singularity which arises from protected operator. This is very nice because protected operator, they don't depend on the coupling constant, so this piece of information is very easy to be extracted, and actually the full function is completely, can be completely recovered by knowing only this protected sector of the theory, which is very nice. Now let me try to make connection with the amplitude. As I said at the beginning, my main object is the amplitude. So how do we go from the four-point function to the amplitude? So the scattering amplitude on ADS5 cross S5 is given by using some Mellin transform. So here is the function that I wrote before, and this is some integral transform, and this is the Mellin transform that I have in mind. Sorry, I don't want to make confusion, but this is the u that I had before, but since u is also a Mandelson variable, I put this prime, which is very bad looking, but that's how it is. So I don't have time to explain a lot all the properties of this Mellin transform, but there is a beautiful story behind. So this function m has very nice analytic properties, so it contains a lot of very nice information, but just let me go to the genus expansion or to the kind of correlation function that I was discussing before. So if we take genus, our four-point function at genus zero, we see that we again get this full expansion. So this is the supergravity result, which, as I said, is fully fixed. Then there is the full lambda or alpha prime expansion. So this is the first truncated solution, which we know up to this coefficient A here. Then there is the alpha prime to the five, or so, which is the second solution, truncated solution, which is given by this term here. Again, this B and B1 are the ambiguities that I was talking about. So we know all the full expansion up to this coefficient here. So all this term, this term is completely fixed by this protected operator, but all these other have this kind of ambiguities here. So now we can ask ourselves, is there any way, sorry, just let me mention this kind of correction are related to the R to the 4 and D4 R to the 4 terms for people who know that. So is there any way that we can constrain this coefficient here, A and B and B1 and so on? One thing that we can do, we can take the flat space limit. The flat space limit is nothing but the limit in which S, T, and U are infinite. Alpha prime goes to zero with this S alpha prime, T alpha prime, and U alpha prime, which are fixed. We can take the flat space limit of our Mellin amplitude, and what we should recover is genus zero, the Shapiro-Virasoro amplitude. By doing this matching here to the flat space limit, actually we can fix all the first coefficient here, in particular A, B, and whatever is in the dots here. B1 we are not able to fix because this is really a curvature correction. But now it comes the magic. Now we fix A and B, but we can also go to genus 1. We take our genus 1 amplitude, we do again the same flat space limit, and then we are left with the flat space genus 1 amplitude. Now, this exactly agrees with the non-analytic part of the type 2B genus 1 string amplitude in flat space, and even more, since we know that the one loop is nothing but the the genus 1 is nothing but the genus 0 square, this agreement here gives also puts constraints on the curvature correction B1 here, which appears at zero order. So by matching the genus 0 and genus 1, we also get back new constraints for the other coefficient that we couldn't match at zero order. And actually, here I showed only few terms, but this can be made very systematic higher and higher in this expansion here. Okay, let me go to some conclusions. So what I discussed today is how to construct this genus 1 string amplitude on curved space by studying the dual correlator. Something that I also discuss is how we can match the flat space limit our results, and by matching this with the flat space, actually we can also give predictions to curvature correction. Something that would be great to do, but that we didn't do it yet, is to understand how to build proper vertex operator in string theory that is not really known so far. Another thing that we could try to do is how to go, and if this is possible, to go to higher genus. Another thing would, that would be great is how to include these heavy states that we were disregarding here. Another thing which is very interesting, if there are other alternative methods to fix this kind of ambiguities without going to flat space. For instance, if there is some numerical bootstrap techniques that we can use to fix this kind of ambiguities. So this is what I wanted to say. Thank you very much.
Other questions? So there may be some non-renormalization theorem that answers this question, but I guess once you go to one loop in supergravity, you have to think a little bit about what's the scheme, or how do you decide, you know, when you say, you know, the Newton constant in the bulk and you want to match it to C parameters, you know, at what scale that's defined or with what kind of cutoff or whatever.
Yeah, so I think for the supergravity there is no such a problem because this is finite. So there is no problem, but for the next terms, yes, you can have this kind of problem. So I didn't talk at all about another issue, which is the issue of divergences.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Which kind of terms you can have, for instance, the R^4 already
has
this kind of problem. And actually we manage also to reproduce this kind of, okay, we didn't really manage to reproduce the divergent coefficient, but we spot the fact that there are divergence is where there should have been. For instance, the R^4 terms has a divergence at spin zero, and we managed to see that kind of divergence also from the CFT side. But we couldn't match the exact coefficient that is in front, because this is exactly related to what you are saying, the fact that there are different schemes that give different. So we should choose a scheme to regularize our infinite sum, which should give another scheme in the amplitude side. So we didn't go through that, but the nice thing is that we spot exactly the divergence is essentially where the counter times should be also in the string side.
Any more questions?
For the ambiguity, we know that the four-point correlator should satisfy the superconformal order identity. Do you think that if we use superconformal order identity, will that be helpful to fix the ambiguity?
Okay, I have to apologize. Because I only had 25 minutes, but we used superconformal word identities completely. So I didn't show the whole story, but we used superconformal word identities to essentially kind of remove all these protected operators to write down only superconformal primaries and so on. But this doesn't help in solving the ambiguities because the ambiguities are given by solutions which are essentially homogeneous solution of the superconformal word identities. So they are satisfied by themselves. They don't give extra constraints.
Okay, thanks.
Any other questions? Okay, let's thank the speaker again.
Okay, so now we have the coffee break and we come back at 3:30.